That's a wee bit hard, isn't it? Mm-hmm. All right, we're going to take a shower, bath, and then we're going to go do some.
Hey everybody, Tom Mascitelli here, your host of the Red Bull Signature Series, and allow me to welcome you to Southern California and the Pomona Fairplex, which for years was a legendary horse racing track until it shuttered its doors last year. Now, it is born as the home of Straight Rhythm, the head-to-head dirt bike drag race of the year. What was once the home stretch is now a half-mile course made up of 80 jumps, 3 speed checks, 150 feet of whoops, a 5 tabletop rhythm section, and an 80-foot jump into the finish line. Our big story today, of course, the return to competition of defending Straight Rhythm champ James Bubba Stewart after a controversial year-long ban from racing. He also has some riders that are gunning for him. New to the event, Ryan Dungey, who comes off of his back-to-back championships in both Supercross and Motocross, and the 2013 250 Supercross champion, Ken Roczen, who has made the move up with the big boys to the 450s. We are all set for our first run, so we're going to check in with Jason Wygant and the legend himself, Ricky Johnson.
Well, thanks, Al. Jason Wygant, joined by 7-time AMA National Motocross and Supercross champion, Ricky Johnson. And everyone here is intrigued at this event, because it's only the second time they've ever ridden on a Supercross track unwound. We still have the fun stuff, all the obstacles. I'm not exactly sure what happens, though, when you take the turns out.
But with Supercross, they say jump for show, turn for dough. That goes out the window. Right here, you got straight, you have jumps, whoops, you have tabletops with a huge finish line jump at the end. But also endurance is going to play a part in this because a lot of drivers think, oh, it's only a 45-second run, but you have to do it time after time after time. It's like intervals.
Yeah, and they're going to be really intense because this is head-to-head racing. We'll give you an idea what the format is. Much like drag racing, we'll start with the bracket. Riders go head-to-head. The best 2 out of 3 runs advances to the next round. Eventually, we'll get down to the finals and crown ourselves a champion. And we have a world-class field of riders on hand. For more on that, let's introduce Will Christian to talk about this deep field.
Thank you, guys. Well, like you said, an incredibly stacked field here at 2015 Red Bull Straight Rhythm. Last year, we saw brothers Malcolm and James Stewart both standing on the podium, James taking the 2014 title, and his brother Malcolm standing in third position. But with Malcolm moving into the light class this year, there is a chance that we might actually see both of them stand on top of the podium. But there's a lot of talented riders who'd like to stand in their way and stop them from achieving that goal. For Malcolm, that includes 3 Geico Honda teammates, including that of Matt Bishalia. KTM have 6 riders in both classes, including the current motocross and supercross champion, Ryan Dungey. And of course, we can never leave out RCH rider, Ken Roczen, who actually qualified for the fastest time yesterday. So, with such a talented field and an unknown track, it really is, guys, anybody's getting here today.
Thanks, Will. So we'll show you the bracket as it stands right now. Earlier, Ken Roczen defeated Tevin Tapia, and Andrew Short defeated Vince Friese. So it'll be Short versus Roczen in our next run. Brayton took out Kidnap. Wilson took out Remet. So it'll be Brayton against Wilson. On the other side, you'll have Dungey versus Partridge, and Stewart versus Hansen. Schmidt, Alessi, Chisholm, and Raper put in good, strong efforts, but they ultimately were eliminated. Andrew Short and Ken Roczen will be facing off here in this round. These guys are good buddies off the track. Kenny spent a summer at Andrew's house 2 years ago training in the United States when he was coming over from Germany. But now, friendship, put it aside, it's time to race.
It was Andrew Short with a really fast time. We see Roczen with very, very hard scrubs going side to side. Andrew Short a little bit more clean than the lane closest to us on the number 29, but Roczen by a nose.
Yeah, we like those horse racing terms.
Yeah, okay,
we'll see if Short can close back in, and he actually has. So Short, right there with Roczen, who is your fast qualifier.
But it was the dragon back. Yep. It was the dragon back that made the difference. And going into the whoops, you see that the whoops is going to be the determining factor because they're doing the jump. said. So Kenny with about a 2 bike length lead going into this last couple sections. There's a little bit of a good ride, but then pulls it off. Cycle here as he enters the grandstand so the fans can see him showing off a bit as he goes on to take the victory. Rematch here between the buddies, Andrew Short on the BTOsports.com KTM and the Soaring Eagle Jimmy John's Suzuki of Ken Roczen. Now Short, he's over the age of 30. He admits he's not one of these young high-flying guys. He told me this morning, he's like, this race is kind of an anti-me. But he wants to work on the weaknesses and get faster in a sprint-type event, so that's why he's here.
Ken Roczen over-jumped a little bit in that preferred left lane, but you see Short very consistent. It's going to take a mistake by Roczen for Short to beat him, but anything can happen in straight rhythm.
Short was close for the majority of the first run, but a quick early edge for the 94 Roczen this time.
We saw Short come up a little bit short on that last transition, but you see right there, Roczen tipping the camelback just a little bit. One hump smaller to clear the next one. Right now he's on the step-on. It looks like he has a clean run all the way to the finish. A little fist pump. A little tribute to Jeff Ward back in the day.
He's a showman for sure. The young German, Ken Roczen. A big whip at the finish line to celebrate that victory. Sorry, Shorty. I love you, but I got to move on. Short is eliminated. Roczen moves on to the semifinals. Give you a couple of replays and show how Roczen did it.
Both of them almost identical, by a nose Roczen, but it's the scrubbing technique of Ken Roczen that where he gets the advantage at the beginning of the race.
And at this point, he's got a solid lead, so why not throw a little flair in it for the fans? Yeah. Fist pump. Short's not close enough to do anything about that. Look over at the fans as well.
Congratulations, two solid races there to get you through to the next round. How important is the scrubbing here? It seemed to be helping you an awful lot there.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean, we don't have any corners, so you got to make up the time somewhere. So jumping's everything. You got to try to scrub whatever you can. Oh, yeah. You got to try and scrub whatever you can. But at the same time, you got to get your timing right and not clip anything or overshoot anything. So.
Now, you look like you're having a lot of fun out there. Obviously, it's an intimidating track, but you guys are enjoying here at Red Bull Straight Rhythm.
Yeah, for sure. You know, this is just a fun race, so we're all having some fun and trying not to go too crazy.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Let's show you what a Supercross track unwound looks like in today's course preview with open class competitor Ken Roczen.
You got Wilson, about 6 foot tall, and
Raiders are quite a bit short of a bulk, about the same in weight. Right now, they're running neck and neck.
And they've been neck and neck every time they've done this event together, last year and this year. And this is the closest run we've seen so far. Wilson at the 15, Brayton at the 10.
Now let's see who goes through the works the fastest, because this is going to determine what happens. And here you see Justin Brayton pulling about a half a bike length lead.
And a lot of riders feel that the lane that Brayton is in is the slower lane, but he's actually pulled ahead now. Wilson, down the stretch they come. Between these two, the whoop section allowed Brayton to extend that lead.
Yep, you see it's the entry speed of Brayton. You notice he floats that one a little bit, but he gets back into rhythm, hitting everyone, floats one, and then, he extends it. That's a scary way of going through there, but you got to give it to the guy. He's got confidence.
Wilson a little bit side to side, a swap through the whoops, and that allowed Brayton to have this kind of a gap, and that would carry him to the checker flag. Line we go with what we believe is the closest matchup of this round, Wilson versus Brayton. And Brayton was only able to get ahead in the last probably quarter of the track. The last time around, they were side by side through the first 75%. But Wilson's going to need to top Brayton here, or he's eliminated.
It seems like that the right lane is faster at the beginning, but the guys seem to make it up from the middle on in the left lane. So we'll see if Dean Wilson gets out to that early lead and what Justin Brayton can do with it.
Yeah, there's something in the middle leading to the whoops that has allowed a couple of riders to get ahead when we normally have a side-by-side battle. That's what Brayton did the first time. Let's see if he can do it again. Brayton on the 10, already establishing the lead on Wilson. Wilson, the Scottish rider on the Red Bull KTM, the BTOsports.com KTM of Brayton. Two different teams, but pretty similar equipment.
But they took that section completely different. Here we see Justin Brayton, the slide advantage once he gets on. Now let's see what happens in the whoops. He's over the dragon back, into the whoops. But Brayton has been probably the most consistent through there all day long. Now he's got about a 2.5-minute lead over Dean Wilson.
This is a great run from Brayton. One of the cleanest and fastest we've seen throughout the entire event. I'm really curious what the lap time is going to be. 42.2 for Brayton. 42.283 for Brayton. Let's see how that lines up. Yeah, that's the fastest that we've seen so far from this group. Justin Brayton, the fastest lap time of anyone in this bracket.
Here we see Brayton at the beginning staying a little bit lower. And here's where they do completely different sections. You see one guy's up, the other guy's down. And that's what's great about straight rhythm, is that you can try your own formula, what's going to work the best. They're doing the same number of jumps, just in different sequence, like a double, triple, or a triple quad, but they're doing it in different times.
Let's send it down to Sal Masekela.
This track has evolved since its inception 3 years ago. Out liked what they saw and gave a green light for full-fledged competition. 2014 was the inaugural straight rhythm at the legendary NHRA drag strip. Now that location presented challenges, but ultimately was still a huge success with James Stewart standing on top of the podium. Today in 2015, our event organizers were able to say, hey, let's go across the grounds over to the Pomona Fairplex, this shuttered horse track that would be the perfect blank canvas to make this year's event the ultimate head-to-head proving ground.
So on this course, we have just under 10,000 cubic yards of dirt.
It's a huge factor to get the dirt just right to build this course.
We're always wondering, like, do we have good dirt? Where are we going to get the dirt? The dirt is our most important thing. The right amount of water is really the thing. If dirt's not watered correctly, then, you know, the track doesn't work the way it's supposed to.
It's got to be processed, right? Otherwise, this thing blows apart and we don't have any bags.
In terms of the build, we have 9 guys on our staff here. So until contest day, we have 2 full weeks, including weekends. If you calculate that between 10 and 12 hours a day, it's a hell of a lot of hours.
The biggest challenge is this course, building it, getting everything on point. So when we get done with it, you have that overhead shot, like everything just looks sweet. It would be very noticeable for straight rhythm to not be straight.
When we did
here. Definitely some big drastic changes. Last year, straight out of the gate, we had the elevated start. It's really going to be a unique obstacle, something they've never done before. Right into a very technical rhythm section, a six-pack that the guys are going to have to get back, power to the ground, get to the first speed check, and that starts the first actual rhythm section. We'll probably see some guys mixing up the lines.
If you look at last year, we basically had a real high-speed finish. We have a little bit of a high-speed finish now, but we have a lot more technical aspects coming in right towards the actual finish line. So a lot more chances for passing and opportunities for them.
Every year, you push yourself to get better. You force yourself and the obstacles you put in, challenge the rider, the speeds that they're able to carry. So this is definitely going to be spectacular.
This year. Here's our updated bracket. We've completed one side of it, and now we're moving to the next side. Now, Dungy, you could argue, is the best rider in the world right now, but don't sleep on Partridge. Very tall rider and really seems to excel in this straight line racing. Was very fast in the first round.
And at this point, he's in the preferred line, so let's see if Partridge can pull it together. Set a suspension underneath that KTM.
But as we expected, look at Partridge keeping Dungy in sight.
The slide was taken by Dungy, losing a little momentum, but now he's got his bike back underneath him, up that drag and back, and now he's pulling that young on the
end. That's what I'd say is key and momentum.
Right. Thank you, Ryan.
Let's send it down to Sal Masekela.
Three-time World Supercross champion James Bubba Stewart is back.
event that he dominated last year with its head-to-head wide-open racing and his mastery of his signature Bubba Scrub, the straight rhythm course and format suit him better than anyone as he hopes to return to both championship form and glory in a rightful place atop the podium.
For me, to be able to win in 2014, it was fun. I enjoyed the event a lot.
The first ever open class champ of Red Bull Straight Rhythm is James Stewart.
I think I had motivation over some of the guys. You know, they knew it was a supercross track. They knew I was really good on it. The strongest person was my brother, so I kind of had my control over him. It's going to be nice to have my first race in over a year. Coming back to defend the champion, I might be a little rusty, but I expect to get it done. I haven't raced in a year, so you don't get that sensation of racing. It's kind of weird that I come to the one event that all it is about sprint speed. And normally that's my forte, but I'm not racing. Steps it up, and those guys are up pretty good. Obviously, Ryan's a champion, and Ken, we know he knows how to scrub. So, I hate to admit this, but I'm actually glad Malcolm's not racing because homeboy's flying right now. So, I guess I need to step up to little brother's part right now.
Got it.
I think I'm going to use this race as, you know, having some fun and get back into it again. And, you know, use the motivation going into next year.
So it's going to be interesting with Stewart. Yes, an event that seems so perfect for his skill set, but with not having raced in a year, really hard to predict how it's going to go. Here's the bracket so far. He mentioned Dungey and Roczen, and they have continued to move forward. Next up, we're going to have Josh Hansen against James Stewart, two of the most talented riders of all. Certainly, Stewart doesn't need much of an introduction. He won this race last year. He's a multi-time motocross and supercross champ. Now, Hansen's racing results might not match up to Stewart's on paper, but there are epic stories of Hansen out on practice days and out in the hills doing some amazing things on a bike. Let's see if he can translate it here.
If you hit him, Josh Hansen is going to make it up. He's up against James Stewart, the defending champion of straight rhythm and the guy that typically doesn't make many mistakes.
Hansen right there with Stewart right now. You can't call it. In fact, I think Hansen is edged ahead now.
He's looking over. Josh, put your eyes back on the prize and quit watching James. He's probably over there thinking, I've got to get to hang out with James Stewart today. But right there, he's giving away in the whoops. And now the advantage, we keep talking about that. I hate to be redundant, but it's the whoops that are making the difference here today.
We're seeing something in the middle of the track that is helping to separate these riders. Stewart has it figured out. Hansen, it's close early, but down the stretch. It's the number 7, James Stewart taking the win.
Josh Hansen was matching James Stewart, you know, bump for bump at the beginning, but it was the middle and the end where James Stewart started to excel.
Yeah, absolutely, and we'll show that to you here. See these six-pack doubles and the wall jump earlier side-by-side, but this midway here, Stewart has a lead in his speed. The whoops is just ridiculous at this point, and he carries that speed all the way through to the end. And they'll re-rack it and rematch them. This will be interesting. James Stewart against Josh Hansen. The winner goes up against Ryan Dungey. Hansen has to beat Stewart here, or he is eliminated. And Hansen has the speed and talent to do it, but you're facing a tall order to say you got to go out there and go faster than James Stewart.
That is not an easy task. Which, if someone gave me that job, I don't know, you want to tap out because anybody can win. And Josh Hansen, sure enough, holds the lead on James Stewart.
Going for it. He had a little lead of Stewart at one point, and then Stewart in the second half of the track found something and was able to get by him. But right now, Hansen has him beaten. Here comes Stewart, though, again, finding something different.
Slightly different rhythm for James Stewart. Hansen had to pause a little bit, and he pulls off. I think he might have jammed the ankle or something like that. He got off rhythm a little bit, and that forced him out. So right now, James Stewart just has to get to the finish line, and he's into the next bracket.
Yeah, Hansen has gone off the track. Not sure if it's a bike problem or something wrong with him physically, but here comes Stewart. Huge leap over the rollers.
Let's look back at that replay. We're not exactly sure what happened, but Josh Hansen has been nursing a sore wrist a little bit. So he comes down. You can see him come up as he lands here. Comes up a little bit long, and he jams his wrist. Next thing you know, you see him start to pull himself off. He's just like, well, I'm not going to take a chance at it. So smart move by Josh Hansen. You know, you can see him hold his left hand. So hopefully he gets better.
Let's send it down to Sal Masekela.
Last year, Malcolm Stewart dominated both this new course and format, nearly bringing home that checkered flag, except his brother James had other plans. However, in 2015, Malcolm makes the switch from the 450cc bike to the 250cc bike and finds himself head-to-head with the likes of Jesse Nelson, Shane McElrath, Justin Hill, and Matt Viseglia, to name a few. The big question is, can that experience and command of last year's open class translate and land it once again on the podium to possibly become the champ in the lights?
Malcolm Stewart's going to hold him off, but as Dad said, that's not a factory bike. They put it all together themselves.
Last year, I didn't have a factory ride coming into Red Bull Straight Rhythm, so this year I got picked up by Geico and Supercross and got hired again for the 2016, so they're a factory 250 team, so I'm around the 250 this year. The major difference is the intensity is a lot more different in the 250 class. You know, you're kind of still trying to make a name for yourself, but the 450 guys are already settled, so they're on the way out. The 250, you're trying to earn that spot for the 450 guys.
The biggest difference between 250 and 450 is engine. 450 is obviously much narrower, has a lot more torque, so it's much quicker, a lot more to hang on to. Going from the 450 to the 250, the power difference is very difficult to get used to. You don't have the power to get over obstacles, you have to carry more speed. If you make mistakes, you kind of ruin your entire run.
The track's a lot more different than it was last year, so a lot more technical. I feel like there's way more jumps, and the whoops are a lot more tougher. Yeah, definitely makes the ride a lot more harder, especially with me being a bigger guy. On the 450, when I rode it last year at Red Bull Straight Rhythm, I could overjump something and still have enough power. You know, this year, since it's back to light class, you know, I have to make sure I hit all my markers right. So, a step back in a way, but I like it because I do have a factory ride now, so I can't complain.
I'm still nervous. I'm still jumping off the start. We'll see.
Jordan Smith, young kid out of North Carolina, completed his
his first professional season here in 2015, but did race this race last year as an athlete. He does have some experience in this type of event. Malcolm Stewart raced it last year in the open class in a big bike and finished third overall. Now it's in the 250s. And Stewart on the number 50, just pulling ahead just a tad from his teammate Smith. Jumping just a little bit, but staying right in the game. And as we talked earlier, the left lane is the preferred lane, but Smith losing just a little bit. We talked about it, but he cannot give up. He has to keep pushing, because even though this is just the first round, if he loses this, he can come back in the next round. So he's got to learn something and not give up. You can see a lot more intensity out of Malcolm Stewart in this run. Mike's been up and down, front low, rear low, sideways at times. He is really pushing for a fast lap time. Now let's see what he can do. 42.6. That's pretty good for a 250.
That is phenomenal for a 250.
So taking a look back at what happened to Smith, it was just a small, he came up a little bit short. And here we see their bats are about identical. Both struck in the same direction. They both like to throw it off to the left. And the next thing you know, you see Smith, when he comes up here, he comes up a little bit short. And the next thing you know, back he goes. So Malcolm Stewart wins the first race against Jordan Smith. It's best two out of three, though. So they'll have a rematch coming up. Now we have a battle between the other teammates, the Lucas Oil, Troy Lee, KTMs, the 13 of Jesse Nelson, the 30 of Shane McElrath. And they've been chasing each other quite a bit. It was a big motocross race in the U.S. Grand Prix 3 weeks ago. Nelson won it. McElrath finished second. Let's see how it turns out here at Street Rhythm.
Neck. They're both side by side. They're both in the rep chip at the same time with Jesse Nelson with a little bit harder scrub.
So Nelson on the 13 just ahead of McElrath. McElrath has actually come back now on the 30 and has evened him up.
It's going to be the one that's going to be the deciding factor here, Jason. So as we see him going up the dragon back, McElrath pulls in front of Jesse Nelson.
Wow, taking the lead away from his teammate.
But he hesitates a little bit coming into the woods. Nelson comes back, so now it's going to be a drag race to the finish.
Down the stretch they come, wheel to wheel. Oh, a mistake! And that is going to allow McElrath to get away. Nelson cased the one tabletop, and that's the difference between a win and finishing second to your teammate. Calling a case, what happens is you get the front wheel over the top, and the back wheel doesn't get over it. You hit the bottom of the engine, the cases of the engine, as they call it, on the jump.
Jesse Nelson, he actually scrubs a little bit too much as he comes off here, doesn't get quite the run he needs, and the rear wheel drops, bam, grabs the case. And why they call it casing is, like you said, it hits the pegs, it brings the bike to a complete stop, drops all the momentum, Garrett all the way to the win. So Nelson gets another shot at it, but Garrett gets a big confidence booster.
Hey folks, Jason Blagant alongside 7-time AMA Motocross and Supercross champion Rick Johnson. We have witnessed some great racing today, but I have a feeling things are going to get even better now. Going to rejoin the semis for the 250s. Malcolm Stewart taking on Jordan Smith. Stewart took the win with a 42.6. It was a lightning fast performance for Malcolm Smith, or for Malcolm Stewart against Jordan Smith. That was a mistake that I was bound to make. Malcolm Stewart, that is James's younger brother. That was by far the best time we'd seen anyone put together on a 250, so Smith has to go over that bar to stave off elimination on the number 39.
Smith with a slight advantage, and he's also in that preferred lane, but we've seen the right lane about a third of the way in be faster, so we'll see if Malcolm Stewart can make that time back up.
So far, so good, though, for Jordan Smith. Perfectly smooth in his section and holding Malcolm Stewart about a half a bike length behind it.
You can hear those bikes rev, as you were saying earlier, Jason, that they're wide open. They're giving it as much as they can right on the rev chip because they want to be in the highest horsepower when the tires touch.
And Stewart in the center, able to take it back. What a good work for the wheels. For Smith sets him up. He has an opportunity. Can he come back on Malcolm Stewart? Stewart in the
great to see the intensity keep going up faster and faster and faster each time.
Jordan Smith, the young kid out of North Carolina, only a little over a year into his professional career, gave Malcolm Stewart a run, ultimately eliminated. I think he matched or even exceeded Malcolm through the woods.
That was close, but I think Malcolm had him just by a little bit. You can see he's hanging off the pack. Smith giving a great run and 100% effort, and he makes it. You can see swapping side to side, but it's Malcolm Stewart that stays a little bit lower. Here's coming the step off to the finish where he makes the difference.
And a little look over the shoulder. Malcolm just knew exactly what he needed, how far over the edge he needed to go to hold on for the victory. He's able to keep it in control, and he acknowledges the fans. Let's go down to Will Christian.
Malcolm, that was quite the race there. Jordan Smith was not going to let you have that easy, but you're now through to the final.
Yeah, no, it feels good to go to the final, so I'm excited. Shane just got that one, so it should be a good battle. I don't know. I think my teammates still has a shot to get on the podium, so we'll see how those two duke it out. But overall, pressure's off, so no matter what, if I get first, or I'll get second, no matter what. But we're going to take this win, though. I'm telling you that now.
Well, I was just going to say, you said pressure's off, but a lot of people are expecting to see you standing on top of the podium there. Have you got any more? Can you dig any deeper here to get this final done?
You know, there's always a final. You always can dig deep, you know, so we'll see what we can do. Like I said, hopefully we get on the, we'll get this number one plate, and I'm trying to get that money. So I got to keep my lights on tonight.
Thank you, Malcolm. Malcolm Stewart, we're going to see him in the final.
Thanks, Will. So another teammate battle, as we'll have Jesse Nelson and Shane McElrath. McElrath took advantage of a mistake by Nelson the last time to take the victory. So Nelson has to win this one, or he will be eliminated.
And some riders, if they make a mistake like that, they crumble. They don't come back. Well, Jesse Nelson, he's already got stitches in his chin from yesterday. He looks past it. What happened 2 months ago doesn't matter. So I do not expect this to be a runaway from McElrath.
His teammate, identical equipment in a race for the finals. McElrath a slight lead on that number 30.
What's funny is typically a rider just whips it to one side or scrubs to one side. Both these guys are ambidextrous. They're going to the right and to the left, which is not common. Most of the time, they stick to one side they like better, but both these guys hit both sides.
McElrath still with the advantage. Time is running out on Nelson. He's going to have to blitz these whoops. He does, but he doesn't make up enough ground. Now he scrubs the backside of that steam chip and allows him to get a pair of back around. Here we go. Back around on the power hard. Side by side through the finish. And I believe McElrath is going to get it by a tenth of a second.
Wait a minute. Correction. It's McElrath by...
I know.
No, there we go. Watch both of these guys scrubbing to the left, to the right. Unbelievable job. Here they see they're throwing into each other, away from each other, and it's so close. But McElrath, like you said, this kid gains confidence every jump. So really, really proud of him.
Yeah, it looked like Nelson had him for a moment. Last speed check, the last big jump after these whoops made a huge difference and set them up for this stretch run. Little bit better lead.
The 30 of McElrath, and that's the difference. It's Bionos.
Bionos.
God, quit that. We're at the horse track. Bionos or Bionos.
Photo finish. Let's go down to Will Christian.
Shane, that was a solid semis run for you there. What was the difference, do you think?
Today, it's definitely all about limiting your mistakes. And even if you have to back it down just a little bit to not make a mistake, I think that sometimes that makes up for sending it sometimes. So it's just about that and just about having fun.
Now, yeah, Jesse did make some mistakes out there, and you clearly capitalized on it. But now you're up against Malcolm Stewart, a guy who really isn't going to give you too many mistakes to capitalize on. So what's your plan going forward? Are you going to have to be more aggressive here?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, this is the finals. This is for first. So we're going to go out and give it all we got and pull a little extra for this one.
Good luck out there. Thank you.
Thanks, Will. Well done so far for the very humble young rider, but yeah, he needs to pull something out. He's got the always flashy Malcolm Stewart in the finals. That is going to be a great matchup. Let's sit here with Al Mascara.
Thank you, Jason. You guys want to see matched up. What do you think about James Stewart's return to racing? And how about the fact that we got to take this old horse track and turn it into a motocross event like Straight Rhythm? We've got plenty to talk about, so why don't you get involved in our conversation? Follow the
Red Bull Signature Series on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or you can go to RedBullSignatureSeries.com, where we have even more exclusive content for you. Plus, you can also download the Red Bull TV app to watch this show and catch up on all episodes from every season. Ryan Dungey and Ken Roczen, two names that have dominated the Supercross and Motocross headlines for the past couple of years. Dungey coming off his career, capturing both the 2015 450 Supercross and Motocross championships, and Roczen, the German boy wonder that captured the 2014 450 class championship, and to many is seen as the future face of the sport. Both were unable to compete in the inaugural Straight Rhythm last year, so they're labeled as rookies in this year's competition. However, having dominated in every other competition, both would like nothing more than to win a title here in 2015.
No, I don't consider myself an underdog at all. Since my first year as a rookie, I could understand.
So if you go table, you triple.
I like this event just for the matter it's unique. We're used to having turns, and we have the obstacles, but usually we have turns and all kinds of different deals, so it's a very challenging track.
The track is, in my eyes, quite a bit gnarlier than last year, since everything's big and kind of peaked up.
Now if you go double, then probably have a low one right there.
Sometimes things look easier than they actually are,
or the other way, sometimes things look harder than they actually are.
It's kind of exciting. I'm looking forward to it.
There's a lot of good guys here. You know, we got Stewart, Ken, Braden, Short. I really just want to take it one race at a time and do the best I can. We're riding with Ken. It just so happened that's the way it ended up. We lined up next to each other. Although it doesn't matter who wins or loses, it's more of a practice time. But I don't think I'm not as good as Dungey at all. When it comes to technique, I think I'm the better rider, but he's always there and he's an absolute tough competitor.
You can't overrush it. There's a lot of speed. You come into things really fast and you gotta be on top of your game.
I really just enjoy the track and I'm gonna give my best no matter if I race.
I think it's a lot of potential for this type of racing in the future of our sport. I hope it keeps growing and a lot of good things to come.
Well, we've arrived at the semifinals of the Open Class. We'll give these guys a shot at each other, Roczen versus Brayton. And I cannot wait to see Ryan Dungey battling with James Stewart. But first with Brayton and Roczen. Brayton is sneaky fast on this type of terrain. Guy was born and raised in Fort Dodge, Iowa, and raced a lot of local fair races instead of traditional motocross tracks. So they just kind of build a makeshift track in the middle of the fairgrounds. So he says he's used to man-made courses like this and always facing different obstacles. Every week they build steep jumps and they build shallow jumps. He's able to adapt to new things. So that's why Brayton feels he's excelled in this event, making the finals last year. He looked awfully strong in the previous round. As for Ken Roczen, he's pretty fast. What type of event it is.
Well, right now what you're looking at is two main events, and I hate the two of these riders aren't going to make it to the next level because they're all so fast and they all deserve to be there. So it's one of those things, you know, you watch certain shows and you like both teams. Well, guess what? I like all four riders, and I hate the two of them aren't going to make it to the main.
Roczen, the 21-year-old out of Germany, now lives here in the United States, spends a lot of his time in Florida. But every one of these riders also spends a few months a year here in Southern California. This is where the teams are located. So this will look at a lot of the testing and the development on the motorcycles. So for a lot of them, this is kind of a stepping stone toward 2016. First chance to shake down some new parts of the motorcycle and kind of see where you are. It's certainly not a traditional Supercross-style race since we don't have turns. But these guys all want to get an edge on each other anytime they line up.
But I think the rider that runs the Red Bull Straight Rhythm is going to walk away with knowledge that a rider doesn't, because you're pushing so hard. And as we said, James Stewart went stiffer on the suspension, so he's learning how much harder he can hit obstacles.
Goes to break. And it's wheel to wheel again. Over the tables together.
sorry, we're looking at the finish line for Emmanuel the last 5 months, and now we're between second and third.
So Brayton, back up against the wall, half feet rocks in the next time out, or he is eliminated, and here we go. Here we go. Ryan Dungey against James Stewart, two of the biggest names in the sport. Both are two-time Supercross champions. We've never seen them in a head-to-head format like this until now. Dungey on the 5, Stewart on the 7. Dungey known for being smooth, smart, calculated, consistent, strong. Stewart so spectacular and fast.
I can't imagine the adrenaline that's going through both of these guys knowing who they're up against.
Slight edge to Dungey as they drop into the course. Stewart coming back using the scrub to his advantage. He has a little lead. Now Dungey has it again.
I love it. Big scrubs out of Ryan Dungey. So we've seen that he is learning. Even though he's such a consummate professional, he pulls out on James Stewart.
And Stewart quickly answers back. They've gone past each other, what, 4 or 5 times in this one already. Center of the track favors Stewart. Now Dungey's going to have to find something to the loose. Stewart has him. Dungey passed him in the final 10 feet of their previous race. Stewart on the number 7 is
back is up against the wall. He has to win this.
What does that do to you as a rider? For one, Ryan Dungey, the confidence that it gives him to beat James Stewart, the defending champion, who has never lost in this. And what does that do to James Stewart's confidence that got past, not the middle, didn't make a mistake, just got outran at the end. And it honestly, it looked like a little bit of suspension that Dungey just ran in the face a little harder. He was able to absorb it.
Ryan Dungey, this year's star in both motocross and supercross, winning titles in both divisions. Stewart won this race last year. Has to win this run, or his day is over as far as trying to compete for the gold. And Dungey has the lead right now.
Very animated Ryan Dungey. I like this. I think he's learning something from all this jumping and scrubbing and all the stuff back and forth. But James Stewart making his way back, and it's been the whoops that's been the difference. So let's see who goes through quicker.
Definitely had a little trick here at the end to close up. Not enough.
But we we've talked about it before, and Dungy, very animated, working very much, so he's going to walk away with this a better Supercross racer and a more dangerous Ryan Dungy come 2016.
Here's the amazing part. Dungy put in his fastest run in that round where he lost, because they were both pushing so far.
That's awesome.
Thank you guys for watching. I'm just going to end it right here. Bye-bye. Peace.